takes the stage when we're on the edge of our seat, saying it's too late. Well, let me introduce you to amazing grace. No matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, him up in righteousness, but that's exactly what he did. No matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, still the truth is the cross has made you flawless.
Good morning, everyone. What a wonderful Thanksgiving day, and I just bless you all this good day. And why don't you just rise as we praise and worship our King?
Amen. Hallelujah. Let's put our hands together this morning for our Lord. Let's wake ourselves up to make praise and honor. Hallelujah.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. And see what our Savior has done. And see how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave.
Father, for your Son, for his sacrifice. We praise you and glorify you for making the way. For there is no other way but through the name of Jesus, through accepting his free gift of salvation, believing that he is the Son of God. Hallelujah. We give you praise and glory. There's evidence everywhere we look that we can see God's existence, creation. Just, it's just so evident, like just the air we breathe, the breeze we feel on our face. It's just, it makes me speechless. Hallelujah.
You are.
The Bible. It gives us direction, gives us strength, it leads us, and we can always find peace in God's word. Always find peace in His will.
Great are you,
you're comfortable, I just encourage you just to raise up your hand. Father, I thank you as we lift up our hands and worship you. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for sending your Son to redeem us, to save us, to put away our sin, to make us righteous. Thank you, Father, that this is the day that you have made, and we rejoice, and we're glad in it. Thank you, Father, that we see the evidence of your love all over our lives. And everywhere we go, we think of your goodness and mercy that follows us. We thank you, Father, that your word is being fulfilled in our lives, that your word does not return to you void. Thank you, Father, for your goodness and mercy. We thank you that you care for us and that you keep us right into the palm of your hands, that we're secure in you. The evil one can in no wise take us out because you protect us. You watch over us. You keep our foot from being caught in any trap or hidden danger. And how we magnify you. We glorify you for your goodness. And we just lift up those, Father, that are suffering loss, loss of a job, loss of health, loss of a relationship, loss of a loved one. Thank you, Father, that as we've been singing about, you're the one that gives us hope. There's better days. You're the glory and the lifter of our head. You're the one that heals the broken heart. You're the one that gives new vision. And we thank you, Father. You're the one that pours in the oil and the wine. You're the one that causes us to be whole. And we trust you, Father, to do what man cannot do, what medicine cannot do. And for anyone that's in the hospital or anyone that's dealing with any kind of pain, any kind of discomfort, even reports that have been very discouraging, thank you, Father. What's impossible with man is possible with you. Thank you for sending your word forth to heal us and to deliver us. Thank you, Father. You watch over your word to perform it. We speak healing. We speak wholeness. We speak health. We speak strength. Thank you, Father. For our leaders, we just lift up our leaders in prayer. Father, our political leaders, including our new premier, the police force, the judges of the land, all those in authority over us in any way, we ask that you give them direction. We ask that you give them wisdom. We ask that you raise up counselors and leaders that have a heart for you, Lord, that have an ear that's attentive to your voice, that can offer great counsel, that can bring direction, can bring help, can represent you well. And Father, we thank you for the opportunity to worship you. We present ourselves to you afresh and anew. For this coming week, we ask for new vision. We ask for direction. We ask, Father, that you have us at the right place, at the right time, with the right people, doing the right things. And we give you praise that you surround us with your faith and love. Thank you for showing yourself strong on our behalf. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Well, happy Thanksgiving. We're honored that you have joined us and that you have decided to worship with us here, either online or here in person. And we just believe that you will experience the goodness of God, you'll experience God's love, and you will experience the love of God's people. And before you're seated, I just encourage you to greet those that are near you and let them know that you appreciate them.
I just wanted to stop everything and take the time today to let you know how very thankful I am that you've been there for me.
want to say thanks for never giving up on me.
Thank you for providing meals for us after Blake's surgery.
Thanks for making sure I always had a ride to chemo.
And thank you for helping me through this difficult season in my life, God.
Thank you, God, for teaching me to be a strong single dad.
Dear God, thank you so much for giving me this new job. I love it.
Thanks for sending Jeff to take my shift last week so I could be with my family.
For keeping me company on the first day of school.
Thank you, God, for helping us get that bill paid.
Thank you, God, for the clothes on my back.
For giving me the courage to speak the truth.
Thank you for forgiving me.
For making my day better.
For giving my life a melody.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God,
for every single day.
And one final thing, God. Thank you for always loving me. No matter what.
Amen. He is good. He loves us unconditionally. And that's what this Thanksgiving weekend is all about. We just encourage you to stand. Well, let's make our confession. Let's release our faith. And just declare, this is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today, I will be taught the Word of God. I boldly confess, my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, I will never be the same. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I'll never be the same. Never, never, never. Never the same. In Jesus' name. Amen. May be seated in His name. Today, I just want to welcome you and say happy Thanksgiving. You know, this is happy Thanksgiving weekend, and we have a lot to be thankful for. We have to recognize that no one has to learn how to be unthankful, but it's a decision that we need to learn how to be thankful, how to be grateful, how to be a happy people, how to be a blessed people. So today I want to talk about learning how to be thankful in every single situation. In 1957, the Canadian Parliament made this holiday official with the following proclamation. I'd just like to read this. A day of general thanksgiving to Almighty God for the bountiful harvest with which Canada has been blessed, to be observed on the second Monday in October. It's wonderful that our nation recognizes the importance of thanking God for the blessings that we are walking in, and to let everyone know that He's the source of our blessings. He's a good God. And it is set aside to also to honor Him for all that He has done. We enjoy the food, we enjoy the football, we enjoy family, but we recognize that He is the one that is the author of every good and every perfect gift. And we want to emphasize this Thanksgiving weekend that all our rejoicing, all our praising, all our thanksgivings are expressions of our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Zig Ziglar said it like this: the more you express gratitude for what you have, the more you will have to express gratitude for. He also said, you will never see a happy, ungrateful person. And if you ever see one, it'll be the first one. Let's look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and we'll be reading from chapter 5, 11 to 19, but we'll just do one verse at a time. Verse 16, says, be happy in your faith and rejoice and be glad-hearted continually or always. The scripture says, rejoice and be glad-hearted always. However, I think we could all agree, this is one of the most difficult scriptures and commands in all the Bible to fulfill. Being joyful, being thankful on a consistent basis. Usually, we are happy when things are going our way, and usually not so happy when we're not getting our way. Most people view emotions like joy and thanksgiving as reactions to what's happening to them. But our emotions are based on our choices as we focus on what Christ has done for us in spite of our present circumstances. That we choose what we are, our attitude. One person said it like this: we are as happy and as thankful as we choose to be at any given time in our lives. Rejoicing, praising, and thanksgiving from the heart to God are not emotional decisions, they're heart decisions. God just doesn't respond to mindless worship where we just go through the motions, that we just say, we praise you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. There, I've done my duty. You know, there's the robots and AI intelligence, artificial intelligence, are replacing a lot of the workforce this day because they don't phone in sick. They don't phone in saying, I'm having a mental health breakdown today. I don't feel like coming in today. I'm going on holidays right now. I'm not going to work overtime. So people are being replaced by robots. But one thing that robots could never do, robots cannot worship and honor God from the heart. We can parrot our praise and thanksgiving. Or we can be like a robot and we could go through the motions, but that doesn't move God. When we worship and when we thank God from our heart, His presence is released. His wisdom is released. His direction is released. His supernatural divine help is activated in our lives. And so when we worship Him, we're not talking about just going through the motions, just saying words, or just acting like we're thankful. We recognize this is a heart relationship. Our spirit is reaching out to His spirit. What's in our heart is reaching out to His heart, and what's in His heart is filling our hearts. Let's look at verses 17 and 18. We'll just read verse 17 first in 1 Thessalonians 5. Be unceasingly in prayer, praying perseveringly. And of course, this doesn't mean that we just sit in a room with a white sheet on and pray 24/7. This is like Daniel. Daniel was in captivity in Babylon, like the rest of his people, for 70 years because of disobedience. They weren't keeping the Sabbaths. But the book of Jeremiah had promised that after the 70 years of captivity, that Israel would return to their homeland. And Daniel was reading Jeremiah, and he recognized, hey, the 70 years has come and gone. It's time for God to fulfill this promise. So Daniel took this promise, and he prayed the promise back to the Lord. And he held this promise to the Lord, and he made up his mind, I'm going to continue to pray until God fulfills His word. 21 days later, an angel shows up and says, Daniel, thank you for standing in the gap and praying my word. God heard your prayer the first minute you prayed. But it took 21 days for us to bring the answer to you because we, the enemy, wanted to stop this. And so what we're talking about praying without ceasing is when you're believing God for something, don't quit. Don't give up. if it doesn't happen this week, next week. You know, God doesn't always settle accounts like we would get a paycheck, where we get paid every 2 weeks or every month. But I'm telling you, he keeps his word. And payday comes. And the answer there, God hears right away. But sometimes we have to put on the whole armor of God. Sometimes we have to stand. And having done all to stand, we remain standing, and then we withstand. And it's not that we're trying to get God to answer. He answers. We don't want to get weary in well-doing. But so we continue in this place of prayer and just have that attitude that I am not giving up on our neighbors. I'm not giving up on our loved ones. I'm not giving up on our family. I'm not giving up on this relationship. I'm going to stand there before God. I'm going to keep bringing his word to him. And it's not that we're twisting his arm trying to get God to do it. Because God is the one that has already accomplished it through the finished work of Jesus. But our part is to hold fast to our confession. Also, verse 18 says, thank God in everything, no matter what the circumstance may be thankful and give thanks, for this is the will of God for you who are in Christ Jesus, the revealer and mediator of that will. Of course, this command from the scripture teaches that every day should be Thanksgiving Day in the life of a believer, no matter what our circumstances would be. That we're to enjoy Thanksgiving 365 days of the year. And of course, Lamentations 3:23 says, it says in the word, God's mercies and compassions are new every morning, and great is his faithfulness. He's talking about every single morning. God is up to something. God has something good for us. God has something planned for us. God is making a way for us. And Psalm 68:19 says that God daily loads us with his benefits and with his blessings. And so, again, it's an awareness that God is working in our life. Even when it doesn't look like he's working, he's working. But one thing we never do is we're never thankful for evil. We're never thankful for the bad things that are going on in life. But it's God's will to take what is meant for our evil and turn it around for our good and his glory. God doesn't bring the trouble in our life, but he'll even take the worst things and the most difficult things and the most devastating things, and he'll turn them around for our good and his glory if we allow him to. You see, it's so easy to become focused on how strong the enemy is, how terribly unjust our situation is, how difficult or impossible our circumstance is. But God wants us to turn away from that. He's not saying that we ignore what's going wrong. He's not saying that we deny that we have problems, but he's saying our focus should be on our partnership with the one who created the heavens and earth, and that his presence is greater, that his power is greater, and that he is a faithful God. That is our focus, especially in the time of trial, especially when things are tough. That is the time we need to have our eyes on him the most. Think of Paul and Silas in the prison. They were in a tough spot. Was it God trying to kill them? No, it was the enemy trying to keep them from fulfilling their destiny. It was the enemy trying to stop them and to discourage them so that they would fall short of what God had assigned them to do. But instead of focusing on how bad the situation is, they began to pray and sing praises unto God, and God's power filled that place. And not only did God comfort them in their time of trouble, but God broke every band of every prisoner. He opened every prison door. He shook that place with a great earthquake. Not a destructive earthquake. It was a quaking of the Spirit of God moving. The engineers didn't have to come in and put a new foundation in that place. This was an entirely supernatural move of the Holy Spirit. And they were set free. What activated their faith? Thanksgiving. Not for what was happening, but for who was greater than what was happening. It was a matter of focus. And again, I just want to encourage you that thanksgiving is what keeps the evil that's all around us from getting in our spirit and getting inside us and causing us to be mopey and causing us to be discouraged and causing us to lose hope and causing us to become a victim in life. Again, you don't need to be thankful for every circumstance, but you need to be thankful in all circumstances. We don't thank God for all the murder and all the hunger and all the perversion that's in the world. But we thank God that no matter what's going wrong in the world, God is always good. He never changes. Thank God that God is good. Don't just focus on the problem, but focus on the things that are going on in your life that are good. Think of David when he went to face Goliath. What did he do? He didn't focus on how big that guy was. He never mentioned one thing about how big Goliath was when he faced him. He never mentioned about how impossible it was to beat him. All he bragged about is what God had done in the past. He had helped me take that bear and take and split him in two, and he caused me to kill a lion with my bare hands, and the same God that helped me in the past will help me again. He'll do it again. What was he doing? He was rehearsing the goodness of God. We need to do that in our lives, especially when we're in a situations like that. Maybe you're in a bad situation right now. Maybe you got a bad report from the doctor. Or one of your kids has given you a lot of trouble. Or there's an issue in your marriage. Or you're in a financial problem. You can't pay your bills. Don't just focus on the problem, but focus on the things that are good in your life. Actually have a journal in your life that you write down the good things that God does. It's good to have a journal, you know, and you can write down what time you brushed your teeth, what time you had a shower in the morning, what time you combed your hair. That, I guess that's all right. But I think we should have a journal in our lives where God spoke to us, where God promised something, where God quickened something to us, or God did something good. We need to keep that on our mind. We need to keep that in our heart. Otherwise, we'll think that God's not doing much in our life. But when we look back and count our blessings and name them one by one, we'll be amazed to see what the Lord has done. And then we're able to go forward. And if you can't think anything good has been going on in your life, just be thankful that you're born again and your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and that when you leave this earth that you're going to live in God's presence throughout all of eternity. Linda and I were at a meeting in the city just recently, and there was an old-time Pentecostal preacher there that he wanted to share something to encourage us. And he'd been in a situation that he didn't want to be. He found himself in a situation that he didn't want to be in. He said that his wife, who he knew and did ministry with before they were even married, and then they pastored for decades together, is now in the hospital. And she'd been in the hospital for 4 months. And she's hanging in there between death and life. And he's saying the importance of keeping our focus right. And he says, number one, you have to be convinced in God's goodness. No matter what is happening in your life or what's not happening in your life, be rooted and grounded in God's goodness, he said. Number two, don't be moved off your stand in God's goodness and faithfulness. Never allow what is going wrong. Never allow what's not happening to cause you to get your eyes off of God's goodness. God is good when we're up. God's good when we're down. God's good when things are going our way. God's good when everything is coming against us. And he said, number three, stay connected to God's people. He said that when I'm going through a tough time, when I'm going through, when I was going through those seasons of discouragement, he said, I could phone people at any time. He says, if it was in the night hours, I could phone somebody in Zambia because they'd be awake. I didn't want to wake up somebody in North America, so I'd phone somebody in Zambia, and I'm saying, tell them the situation. And he says, we heard about it, and our church has been fasting and praying for days for you. Or phone somebody in China, somebody in Israel, and they'd be praying. And then during the day, he could phone somebody in Quebec. He could phone somebody in British Columbia. He could phone somebody in Manitoba. Why? Because there was the body was there. But the first of all, he said, never be moved off God's goodness. Stay, he says, that is what has kept me moving forward. As he's been standing in there for his wife, he's been able to keep his sanity because he's rooted in God's goodness. Thanking God in everything, no matter what the circumstance, I'll say this again, is one of the most difficult commands in all the Bible to obey on a daily basis. It doesn't say, thank God occasionally. Thank God when everything is going your way and when you're happy. No, it doesn't say that at all. It says, thank God. Period. But God would never ask us to do something he didn't give us the grace and the ability to do it. That'd be very unfair. A person came complaining to his pastor and said, Pastor, how can I be thankful when I can't even pay my bills? The pastor said, if you can't pay your bills, thank God that you're not one of your own creditors. Rejoicing and being thankful is easy when the business turns around, when you get the job, you get the promotion, when your baby's well. But what about the times when what you're experiencing contradicts what you're believing God for? See, we're to always be rejoicing, always to be praying, always to be in a place of thankfulness. In every situation, not for every situation. We're thanking God for who he is. Everything that has happened to us is not always God's will, but regardless of what's happening to us, giving thanks to God in our situation is always God's will. No person in their ever loving right mind would ever believe that rape, murder, cancer, and other problems are blessings from God in disguise or otherwise, and that we're to give God thanks for these things. No one would ever. That's blasphemy. 1 Thessalonians 5:19 says, do not quench, suppress, or subdue the Holy Spirit. When we're not thankful in a tough situation, when we're not thankful when we're not getting our way, when we're not thankful in a situation, we're disappointed with God in a situation, we quench the Holy Spirit, we grieve the Holy Spirit, we shut the door for the anointing to work in our lives to remove burdens and destroy yokes. We shut the door for God to come and help us supernaturally. Let's never lose our thankfulness. We want the Holy Spirit to be able to do everything that he wants to do in and through us. Thankfulness, and of course we're going to have Brittany come right now. Thankfulness, rejoicing, and praise are always expressions of faith and trust, and our response to the presence of the Holy Spirit at work in our lives. Miss Brittany? Miss Brittany has a testimony she would love to share with you.
I'm not sure what's worse, when pastor gives you 3 days to prepare for your testimony or if he asks you 10 minutes before. I was fortunate to have the latter, so I've just been a nervous wreck for 3 days. Before I do start my testimony, I do want to say thank you to our pastors and a couple others in the church. You guys are constantly our prayer warriors in our lives, and we're very grateful for you. And this testimony is no different. I'm going to give a bit of a backstory so that my whole testimony makes a little bit more sense. As most of you know, you've known me for most of my life. I've worn contacts and glasses for a good portion of my life. I got my first pair of glasses when I was 10 years old. And I got laser eye surgery to correct my vision about 2 years ago. When I did get my first pair of glasses at 10, I was also diagnosed with a fairly common eye disease called lattice degeneration. I'm not well versed in ophthalmology, but throughout the years I've gained a basic concept of the understandings of the eye. But if anybody like knows more than me and would like to correct me later, feel free. Lattice degeneration deals with the retina of your eye. So the retina of your eye is the inner part of your eye. It's connected to the sclera. I believe it's like a gel-like substance. Anyways, lattice degeneration causes weak spots in the retina. So I was vulnerable to getting what's called retinal detachments or tears. This sounds about as scary as it is. This is literally when the retina peels away from your sclera, causing permanent blindness if not rectified quickly. So anyways, it's still very rare even with my condition, but I was told the things to watch out for if this were to ever happen to me. So at the beginning of July, I am 8 weeks postpartum, just cleared from my C-section surgery to deliver my little boy, and I noticed a constant flashing in my left eye with a cloud coming over the corner. This didn't sit well with me, and of course this happened on a Friday night, so there's no optometry offices open on the weekends, but I had a check in my spirit, and so I called Health Links. I went into the ER, and I couldn't shake this feeling that there was something wrong. So as I was in the ER, they contacted the ophthalmology office at Misericordia Hospital in the city, and I got a appointment to see them the following day. This was a Monday then that I would go in for this appointment. So we went in the next day to the city. We saw three ophthalmologists. They all checked my eyes. And they said that there was holes in my retina, which I've been told this my whole life. But because I was symptomatic now, they wanted to get them lasered so that they would be shut, so I was no longer symptomatic. So they tried to get a hold of the surgeon's office, which was at the Winnipeg Clinic, and of course, they couldn't get a hold of him. And so one of the ophthalmologists left. The other ophthalmologist, obviously, I call her my godsend because I think that none of this would have happened if it would have been for her. She told me to just go over to the Winnipeg Clinic where the surgeon was, where he had his office, and she would be there shortly to try and get me in. So we went over there, and I got in, and the surgeon, he took one look at my eye. He was probably looking at my eye for about 30 seconds, and he told me with not a whole lot of emotion or bedside etiquette that I indeed had a retinal detachment. So if this was not going to, like if I didn't go in for surgery for this, I would go blind in that eye. Now this has been a fear of mine since I got diagnosed with this. Like no one wants to lose their vision, right? I can think of 100 things that I'd rather have done to me than lose my vision. So as he tells me this, you know, you're hit with shock and he just continues to go and you don't even really have time to process that. But in that moment, I had a profound feeling that God would not give me this unction in my spirit just to let me go blind anyways when I listened to it. So we went in the next day for surgery. It was emergency surgery. It was called a scleral buckle. It's where they put a silicone band on the outside of my sclera to hopefully pull the retina back to my sclera and reattach it. Now, if you don't get surgery done pretty quickly, eventually that retinal detachment just goes all the way to your optic nerve or your macula, and you lose complete vision, and they can't change or fix that at all. So he told me there was about an 80% chance of this working, which sounds like great odds. But when the surgeon doesn't sound super optimistic, all of a sudden 80% doesn't sound that great. So there was definitely a lot of praying and a lot of, just choosing and like reading the word and just choosing to look to him. So Psalm 91 was a big, big verse that we declared over my life and over this situation, that I would find refuge in his wings. And so anyways, after the surgery, it was a fairly invasive surgery, so the recovery was not great. It was very painful. But we went in to see, or I went in to see him the next day after. I spent the night at the hospital, and then I saw him later that morning. And he said that, he actually said, the surgery went okay. That's not exactly what you want to hear from your surgeon. But anyways, he said that the retina looked like it was in much better positioning, but he wanted to see me in a week to make sure that it was reattaching correctly. Now again, all I'm thinking is I could be the 20% that this doesn't work. And I could go completely blind. So anyways, it was, you know, listening to God. And it's funny because some of the things that I have written down are very similar to what the pastor has already said. It's not a one-time epiphany where you just are like, oh, you know, God said I'm going to have my restored vision. And, you know, you don't have to fight a spiritual battle anymore. Like, no, the devil's going to work extra hard to try and get you to listen to him and not God. And it's definitely a lot easier to listen to the devil than it is to listen to God sometimes. It feels like he can be a lot louder. So anyways, a week later, I went in to see the surgeon again. The recovery, like, I couldn't open up my left eye. I don't know if anybody saw me that during that time. There was about a three-week period there where my eyes was basically, like, shut. It was completely red. It was incredibly uncomfortable. And because I am a nursing mom, I could take zero medication. So I just had to do this naturally. So anyways, I went in to see the surgeon a week later, and my retina was still attached, which was amazing to hear. But again, he wanted to see me again in a month to do laser on my right eye. Because I have the weak spots in both my eyes, he wanted to do some laser in my right eye just to make sure that, like, we could prevent that from ever happening in that eye as well. So anyways, I went in a month later. He told me it could take a long time to do this laser and that I might have to come back for several procedures. He was lasering that eye for about 2 minutes, and he's just like, oh, I got it all. So also a godsend there. And then just, oh, what was it, a week ago? Just over a week ago? 2 weeks ago? I went in for my final checkup with him. Well, hopefully my final checkup with him. And he said that everything has gone well. My retina is fully attached, and I have full vision back. thank you. You know, it's I've been thinking about this as Pastor asked me to talk about this, and I knew I was going to cry because it's a crazy situation. It's easy to come to church on Sunday morning when life is good and believe all of the stories of the Bible and that God is faithful and he is true. It's an entirely different situation when life is not going your way and you are standing in a valley staring at a mountain that seems incredibly ominous and your situation feels very bleak. It's very difficult to trust in him and know that he's got you. And it is a constant every single day waking up and believing those words, because he did tell me that my vision was going to be restored. But it's a lot harder to believe that when you're in recovery and you know, and it doesn't seem like this is actually going to work. But if I hadn't listened to God and I would have listened to the devil, I wouldn't be standing here with full vision in both eyes. I would be blind in one and potentially getting a retinal detachment in the other. So I'm very, very, very grateful that I listened to that check in my spirit. And I hope my testimony can encourage others to listen to that check as well.
Thank you, Brittany. We really appreciate that, because like Miss Brittany said, it's so easy when everything is going our way to lift up our hands and praise the Lord. And I tell people, they say, how you doing? Oh, blessed and highly favored and walking in the fullness of God. But it's altogether different when you're facing problems. But let's put up Psalm 100 and verse 4. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and a thank offering, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful and say so to him. Our words have so much to do with what happens in our life. Bless and affectionately praise his name. And when we come to God with thanksgiving and offerings of thanks, what we are telling our situation is that God is still on the throne, and as Miss Brittany said, he's got us. He's got our back. He's bringing us through. This is going to turn out for our good, is what we're doing when we're praising. And this is something we have to learn, because it is so easy to complain, which is the exact opposite of rejoicing. No one has to teach us how to complain. But thanksgiving and praise are simply reactions to the presence of God at work in our lives. That's what it is. No one has to teach a baby to be a crybaby or a child to be selfish, but we have to learn to be worshipers. Have you ever been around somebody that's constantly complaining? That the glass is always half empty? Complaining, which is the opposite of thanksgiving, is our natural response to the things that we dislike in life. I heard about a woman who was married to a man that was a constant complainer. And that, no, it's not Linda. No matter what she did for her husband, it was never good enough. One morning, she got out of bed determined that she is going to please him and he is going to be thankful. She said, "Sweetheart, what would you like for breakfast? I'll fix it the way you like and I'll make anything that you want." He said, "All right. I want 2 pieces of toast. I want 1 whole wheat, and I want 1 white bread. I want the whole wheat bread lightly buttered. Nothing on the white bread. And I want 2 eggs. I want 1 fried over easy, and I want the other scrambled. Got it?" She said, "Got it, sweetheart." Even though she made him breakfast just like he wanted, he still had that sour look on his face. She said, "Darling, what's wrong?" He said, "You scrambled the wrong egg." There are people that no matter what you do for them, they're always complaining. Just think of God. He's got 8 billion of us to work with. There's some people that they're never happy. Don't let that be you. For goodness sake, Daniel was rejoicing in the lion's den, and God shut the mouth of the lion. What do you do when your spouse walks out the door to live with somebody else? What do you do when you're passed over for a job when you're better qualified, you're better trained, and you're well able to do a better job than the person who got it? Throughout the Bible, we see it over and over and over again. The person that went through the greatest trial was in line for the greatest blessing if they kept their focus right. From the time we pray until the time the promise is fulfilled, we are engaged in what the Bible calls the good fight of faith. It is the trying of our faith. And thanking God, no matter what the circumstance, and no matter what other people are doing, is what activates the anointing and the power of God in our lives. And it is what allows God to do exceedingly abundantly beyond anything we could think, dare, ask, or even imagine. It's the key to the supernatural. It's the key to the miraculous. And miracles are still happening today for the worshipers. No wonder God said in His Word, I'm looking for worshipers. Those that will worship me in spirit and truth. Not those that will worship me according to circumstances. Most of us do really good when things are good. It's just when we don't get our way is where we have problems. We won't take the time to look at it, but just think of the... I don't know if you ever heard the story of the 10 lepers, Luke 17. There was 10 lepers. They were in quarantine. They had health rules just like we have health rules today. They couldn't be around people in case they infected them with their leprosy. So they had to stand away from people. They were isolated. They were outsiders. They were in a bad place. They couldn't be with their family. They couldn't work. They couldn't go uptown. They couldn't hang out. Couldn't see their children. Couldn't see their wife. They heard Jesus was going by, and they cried out with a loud voice, Jesus, have mercy on us. Help us. Jesus told them, go show yourself to the priest. The priest stood in the place of doctors today. And have yourself examined. So as they're on their way to get their physical, they weren't healed before they went. It was a step of faith. It'd be easy to get checked out if you were healed and then get it checked. That's wonderful. You know, God heals us, and then we go to the doctor to verify that we've been healed. They were just as full of leprosy when they started out towards the priest as they were before Jesus spoke to them. It was a step of faith. They weren't healed supernaturally. They weren't healed, I wouldn't say supernaturally, but they weren't healed instantly, which is unusual in the ministry of Jesus. But they weren't healed instantly. They were healed as they went. But when they got, it doesn't say how far they walked. I don't know if they walked 5 minutes, 10 minutes, an hour, 5 hours. I don't know. But on their way, they were healed as they took that step of faith. Because without faith, we can't please God. And it was an act of their faith to step out. And they were healed. They were cleansed, the Bible says. But one of them took time to give thanks. We're in Thanksgiving weekend. Sometimes we're just saying, would you be quiet so that we can get home for the football game? But he stopped and thought, I haven't even thanked God for what he did. And the Bible says he was a Samaritan. I don't know what that means. Obviously, he wasn't a churchgoer. Obviously, he was a stranger to the covenants of promise. Obviously, the other people knew you better. But sometimes when we get what we want, then we leave God out of our life until we're in another crisis. And then we're back in prayer again. That's not worshiping always. And so he stopped and he returned back to where Jesus was. He fell at his feet and began to worship him. Jesus said, where's the other nine? They got their healing. They got what they wanted. Jesus said they got their healing, but because of your worship, because of your thankfulness, you are made whole. That word whole is the word sozo in the Greek, S-O-Z-0. It means salvation. This man, he got healed, but he also got salvation. He got set free. I want you to know Thanksgiving is powerful. This man that came back and offered thanks got more than what anybody else got. And he didn't deserve it. You know, when Jesus fed the 5,000 families, the first thing he did when he took those 5 loaves and 2 fishes that were not enough to feed 5,000 families? How many know when you don't have enough food, you don't have enough food, right? He just had 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Do you know what he did with that? He gave thanks. Well, then, when he gave thanks, what happened? That which was not enough became more than enough. Do you know that when it was all said and done and they fed the 5,000 families, that there was more food left over than what they started with? They put more stuff in the baskets than what they started with. That's the power of praise. Not for what's happening, but for who is with us, who is in us, and who is working in our life. He's going before us and preparing a way for us where there's no way. Thanksgiving is powerful. So let's be like the Samaritan, the alien. And we're all aliens. This isn't our home. You know, it's winter's on the way. There's a day coming, and it's very soon. We're going to be in a place where we won't be shoveling snow. We won't have frostbite. And we're going to spend all of eternity. But it takes a thankful people. That Samaritan made the choice. He wasn't thanking Jesus for the leprosy. He was thanking him that you're my healer. You're my provider. You're my savior. So I'd encourage you, don't be like the man with the whole wheat toast and the 2 eggs. Let's be thankful for what we have. And we got him. And when we got him, we got everything we need in this hour. You say, well, what about the government? What about what's going on with the economy? I'm telling you, we have someone that is for us and with us that supersedes what's happening in the natural world. He can overwhelm any situation that we're in as long as we position ourselves with thanksgiving, with praise. And like Miss Brittany said, it's easy to come to church and lift up our hands and go through the motions when everything's going our way. We're blessed and highly favored. We're children of the Most High God. But when we're facing an impossible situation, that separates the men from the boys. And that's where God moves. I just encourage you, make up your mind today to be a worshiper. Make up your mind, just think of areas in your life that you don't like and start to find a promise and begin to worship God over that situation. God wants to change it and turn it around for your good more than you do. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you that you're a miracle working God. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. We thank you that it's praise that steals the enemy. It is worship and thanksgiving that activates our faith. Because, Father, we cannot separate faith and praise and worship and thanksgiving. They all work together. A worshiping person is a person of faith. A faith-filled person is a worshiper, is a praiser, is a joyful person. And Father, we access the joy of the Lord, not by having good circumstances, but by having a good God that never changes. And so, Father, we just thank you for everyone here and everyone watching. If there's anyone here that has never experienced the goodness of God, the favor of God, the blessing of God in your life, I want you to know that this Samaritan, he was an outsider. He didn't deserve salvation. He didn't belong to the right group. It doesn't make any difference. In Christ, we come as we are, and he accepts us as we are, but he doesn't leave us the way we are. If you've never received him, or at one time you served him, but you had a bad situation, you were mistreated, or you experienced some injustice, and you think God failed you, I want you to know today, God never failed anyone, and he never will. Because God's love, and love never fails. And you realize today you've been duped, you've been deceived. It was the enemy that got you out of church. It was the enemy that got you out of the Bible. It was the enemy that caused you to walk away from the goodness of God, and you're coming back today. If that's you, this could be the greatest Thanksgiving weekend that you have ever experienced. What time would be better than now? So if you've never come to him, or you want to come to him today, or want to come back to him today, let's just say these words. Let's just repeat them together. Say, oh God, I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is God's Son, and he's my personal Lord and Savior. I believe with my heart that God raised you, Lord Jesus, from the dead for my salvation. Fill me with the Holy Spirit that I may serve you with gladness all the days of my life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, if you prayed that prayer for the first time and you prayed it from your heart and you meant it, you're born again, you're a child of God in the family of God, we have some information we would like to give you. If you're online, just use the address on the screen. We'll send the information to you. Congratulations. I just want to encourage you today, be a thankful person. Have a spring in your step. Allow the joy of the Lord to be your strength. Not because everything goes your way, not because of what you have, but because who you have. You have him. And when you have him, you've got everything you need to be blessed and to be victorious and to be happy. Happy are the people whose God is the Lord. Amen. Happy Thanksgiving. Trust that you'll get more to eat than you deserve, and the calories won't bother you. You'll have good fellowship, and it'll just be a blessed weekend. And you'll brag on God everywhere you go. God bless you. We dismiss you with our faith and love. I want to remind you, when you leave this place, you don't leave his presence, but you take his presence everywhere you go, because now he's living his life in and through you. You're not living for God. God is living through you. God bless you. Be blessed.